Huh?
Yes, sir.
Give him book.
Hussein's brother.
Yeah, the Hussein's brother.
MashaAllah.
Now we'll see which one, huh? Read English, not Urdu. Is it Mac?
Zaid.
Zaid, MashaAllah. Zaid ibn Haritha. Was Zaid ibn Thabit. The only name that mentioned in the Quran is your name. نعم فلما قضى زيد منها وطر. The only name of the Sahaba. Was زيد رضي الله عنه. نعم. تفضل. سافر بسم الله والحمد لله.
Chapter 4. Lending something for you. Ariyah. Okay.
Raise your voice, listen, please.
Okay. May Allah have mercy on all of them. Define Ariyah as a permission for benefiting from an article whose use is permissible. And then the borrowed article remains until it is returned to its owner.
Okay. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. Our chapter here speaking about Al-Ariyah. طيب Al-Ariyah هذا الايه عين حقيقة عاريه والعاريه يعني كما ذكرت as I mentioned earlier it's from the verb عاره يعير which means to lend somebody something of your own to use it and then return it to you. طبعا هذا كلمة عارية it include anything إعارة anything not only article sometimes we use it with people. طيب تقول لك إعارة موظف إعارة an officer who work in one company طيب to work in other company and then he will return to his company إعارة sometimes college schools. Okay, they said, مثلا, will you send us one till we have shortage of teachers. Earn me one of your teachers. That means, send me one of your teachers to teach this semester or this year. That means he's still in the responsibility of the first party. Right? I mean, he's working in this company, but he worked for temporary time. Another company with arrangement between the two sides. طيب. So the word أعارة is not limited only to objects. This is the meaning of the word itself. طيب. Now we come to the إعارة that we are studying today. So we turn to the تعريف of الفقهاء. This is why he started فقيه define. طيب. Why should we go to the definition of the faqih? It's a good question. As usual, as always, I'm telling you that there are always, for any term, in the Islamic study or Islamic law, there are two meanings of the word. Or you can look at the word from two sides. The linguistic meaning of the word and the terminology that meant in this area, in this field. Clear? Because sometimes the word, the linguistic meaning is what? Clear for everyone. But you don't define it as term, it's different from one field to another field. As I explained before, example, for the word sunnah, the word sunnah. Sunnah, in the linguistic, what does it mean? Way. Right? Sunnah, linguistic, way. No, we are talking linguistic now, not a salah. Salah is the terminology, the term. Lugatan. Lugatan, linguistic meaning. طيب way you can say for example this is sunnati, I do this and this, my way. Right? This is in the language. Right? When you come to the terminology, it's different meaning in the field of hadith and in the field of fiqh. Okay? Salam. Different. The meaning is not the same. Why? Because this, the term, in the area of hadith, it has definition. On the area of fiqh, it has different definition. As said. So the word sunnah, if we took it in the hadith, means whatever the Prophet ﷺ said, or did, or approved, or didn't approve, or some ad, or any of his character. Consider as sunnah. The way he wear his clothes, the way he sleep, the way he do this, the way, and also include the hadith saying, this is why we say the kitab was sunnah. Refer to whatever the Prophet ﷺ is tradition of the Prophet. This is the sunnah in the field of where? Hadith defined. But if you come in the field of ahkam, the definition of sunnah is different. The same word. As-sunnah هي ما يؤجر على فعلها ولا يعاقب من تركها. As-sunnah في العبادات. Here we define the sunnah in عبادات, in acts of worship. As-sunnah في العبادات, in acts of worship, that any act that if you did it, you will be rewarded. And if you didn't, you will not be punished. That means optional. You see, get the point now? So you have one word with one linguistic meaning or more, but when you apply it in different fields, it takes different meaning. So this is why, brothers, it's very important for the person who is working or seeking knowledge. Not only in this, many contracts, the first thing that they do in the contract, they define the terms they use. Right or not? You are working in business. And you know this? Huh? Yes, always in the any area, in politics, okay, in economic. Why? What's the purpose that people, you know, emphasize the importance of giving the meaning in al-istilah? So people, they understand what they are talking about. Otherwise, everyone will understand it, what? In different way. And everyone will be right. Right? Why? Why? Because this word implies this meaning. So this is what we call it, istilah. What's the meaning of the word istilah? From the word istalaha. Istalaha. From sulh. Okay? That means we agree between us about this particular meaning for this word in this context, in this regard. So called istilah. This is the meaning of salah. So always you'll find, you will find, they tell you that the meaning of this word, lughatan, means in the language, this and this. And the meaning in al-istilah, the meaning in al-istilah, which is terms or terminology they use in this, like this and this. Clear? So here we are now speaking about definition, okay, about the word al-ariya, in the field of fiqh, in the ahkam. What does it mean? طيب. He said, the faqih or fuqaha, and those fuqaha are in ulama who are specialists in fiqh, because we have fuqaha, we have muhaddithun. Okay? In fact, most of the time, The faqih is muhaddith or the opposite. طيب, but not always. Not always. طيب, like for example, Imam Ahmad. Many of us, they know about madhab Imam Ahmad. They think that Imam Ahmad is faqih. In fact, he is muhaddith. Because he wrote the book, Al-Musnad, which is a collection of hadith. But with this, when he comes to explain it, you know, now he talk about al-ahkam here. Right? But sometimes you'll find the muhaddith, he know the hadith. He tell you about the isnad. You want to ask him about what's the rule about this? He said, ask faqih. Ask the fuqaha. Why? Because the fuqaha, they will check different saying, and then they will tell you the dalil of everyone. Anyway, we talk about the meaning of fiqh before. طيب. So those fuqaha define Ariyah is a permission, look at, for benefiting from an article whose use is permissible. This is the first condition. The ulama, when they put definition, they try to put it where, what? Have precisely in the right way. طيب. A permission, we understand it, for benefit. That means you allow me, you give me permission to use something that you own. خلاص? Clear? Clear. But they said an article whose use is permissible. That means if this thing or use it is forbidden, then should not be done or cannot consider of al-ariya that you apply the rules about it. Okay? You cannot, certain things cannot be lent to others. طيب. You lend somebody, you give somebody something that he may use it and something which is haram. طيب. So this is what he said, use is permissible. And then the borrowed article remains until it's returned to its owner, which is different from the gift. طيب. Different from the gift. Different from the waqf. And we'll talk about awqaf inshallah later on. طيب. Different from the gift. What's the difference? When you give somebody as gift, it will be what? His, khalas. Or her. But when you give somebody something to use, it is aria because he will retain it to you. Clear? So this is our subject about that. Now, continue.
The aforesaid definition excludes whatever is impermissible to use. For such a thing is naturally prohibited to be lent. It also excludes any object that cannot be used without being consumed, such as food and drink.
Why? Because if you consume it, how can you retain it? Huh? How can you retain it? Right? You lend them this glass of water and he drink it. Can he retain it?
He can't buy another one,
but it's not the same. You are talking about the same object. Not replacement. Okay, we talk about that the article that you give by itself should not be consumed in a way that it will be finished. Khalas. Naam? Fine.
Lending objects for use is legal according to the Quran, the Sunnah, prophetic tradition.
Fine. Now here the Shaykh, Jazallah khair, he started his argument to tell you about what's the basis of the permissibility of Ariyah. And he mentioned three main sources. Which is the main sources? طيب. And some ulama, they say this is the only sources. Some add al-qiyas or others. But these are the main sources. In fact, the main sources are two. the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But then they add or derive from these two sources al-ijma', because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned that the Ummah will not, you know, agree all in something which is wrong. So al-ijma' was taken as one. So this Shaykh here is telling you that there is no doubt that this kind, okay, of way that people deal is allowed and permissible. And in the Quran was mentioned, in the Hadith, the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also all the Ummah is agree in this. Now he will present to you where the Dalil. Now,
Allah, exalted be He, states in the Quran that He damns those who withhold simple assistance. Quran, Al-Ma'un, Ayah 7.
Right, Alladhi, this Surah Al-Ma'un. Huh? Ha? لا قبلها ها يمنعون المعون يمنعون المعون الذين يمنعون يمنع prevent or stop المعون من العون إعانة أعانة help. So those who prevent helping others or preventing any help to get through. يمنع means to stop, to block. معون, okay, any help. نعم نعم.
The verse refers to those who withhold the different wares and articles that people use and lend each other.
Yeah, this is one of the tafsir. He said that this verse refers to those, okay, who don't help others by lend whatever they have. You have, for example, something that your neighbor needs, or your friend, or your classmate, or anybody can need. He said, please, will you lend me this to do? Somebody is in the line, he wants to fill an application, and he has no pen. And so he said, can I take your pen? No. Afraid that it will gun. Right? No. This now is in need, right or not? So it's... But be careful with this pen, because many of these pens will go. Not because people, they want to take it, but because they forgot. So I like some people, what they do, when they give you the pen, yeah, they keep the cover, the cap. So we will make sure that for a tenant, you know, just not to do that. But the point is that you need to help each other. Nah.
Those who abstain from lending such objects to people in dire need of them are dispraised in the above mentioned verse.
Nah. So as the Shaykh is mentioned, telling here that this verse is applicable here. Apply to those people who don't lend others. Nah.
That proves the obligation of lending as maintained by Islam,
Ibn Taymiyyah. This is why some ulama said, okay, that lending is must and it's not optional for the one who needs it. From this is their saying. It is must, not optional. It's not up to you to give or not to give. But it is must on you. As long as you can help your brother, then you should lend him. Unless you know that this guy always he takes things and never returns it. This is a different story. Right? So this is to some ulama say must, but not all. Naam? Right.
Lending money is not covered, is it?
Naam? No. We will talk about this in deen. Money in deen. Okay? When we talk about deen. Okay?
Provided the owner of the needed object is well to do. It is stated in the Sunnah that the Prophet ﷺ borrowed a horse from Abu Talha and also borrowed shields from Safwan ibn Umayyah.
Right, this is, now we turn to what? The Dalil from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So the dalil, the proofs from the sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the Shaykh gave what? Two practical examples of the acts of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. He said that he borrowed a horse from Abu Talha. He used it under the tent. Right? And also, he borrowed shields from Safwan ibn Umayyah. He borrowed this. So this has been since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet alayhi wa sallam did it. Then it is what? This is dalil. This is evidence that the Prophet alayhi wa sallam did it. Practice it. Nah.
Lending something to someone who badly needs it is regarded as an act of obedience to Allah.
Nah.
For which the lender will be greatly rewarded by Allah.
طيب, what's the relation between an act of obedience to Allah for which the lender will be greatly rewarded by Allah? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards you for acts that He loves. Fayturna. Huh? That He loves. When you do something that Allah loves it, this will be considered as ibadah. Right? What's the definition of ibadah? The definition of ibadah, whatever Allah loves of acts and saying. Right? Of acts. And this acts either hidden, or visible. Hidden, that means the acts of the heart, like al-khashya, wa-tawakkul. And visible, like, you know what you do when you do salah, or charity, or whatever. All these acts of, because Allah loves it. Or saying, that like dhikrullah, subhan, tasbih Allah. So anything that the Muslim do, any deed that do it, for the sake of Allah, and Allah Azza wa Jalla love it, either by command, this or by the Prophet ﷺ, he commands or encourages us to do it, this will be considered as ibadah. And when you lend your brother something that he needed, are you responding to the command of Allah or not? Yes, because Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. طيب, and there's many verses in the Quran and many of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ encourage the Muslim to what? To be in the help of his brother. And this is why he said it's obedience and acts of obedience to Allah Azza wa Jalla. But here, brothers, this is very, very important. When you give this or you help anybody, you should put this niyyah in your heart. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. طيب, not because you are afraid of him. If you didn't lend him, he will be mad at you. Or he will break relation with you. طيب, or you are give him this because you have planned after some time, to get some help from him. No. Do it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah will reward you for this act. Nah.
This is because it falls under the general meaning of mutual assistance and cooperation in righteousness and punishment.
This is what we mentioned in the ayah, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ. Nah.
There are four conditions for the validity of lending.
Right. Now we will talk, we'll speak about what are the conditions, because not any lending is okay or lawful. Because also, these conditions will explain to you what's the right and the responsibility of both parties. Right? If it was damaged, for example, who will be responsible about this? Is the owner or the one who took it? Lend it. Okay. Right. So we'll see this inshallah one by one. Now.
Number one. The legal competence of the lender to lend. As lending is a kind of donation which is invalid to be done by a minor, a sane person, or a foolish and weak-minded one.
This is very important. Why? Because here we know that those little kids, for example, minor, like foolish or weak mind, they, in fact, they have no authority even in their own money. You remember when you talk about Al-Hajr before? the person could be stopped from using his money because he, if it was left for him, he will destroy it or waste it. Right? So it's not, for example, you give your little child, somebody came and asked him to give him the key of the car of his father. Can he do it? No. Little boy, not in the reach, the age, or somebody who is foolish. I mean, he can waste whatever he has. Also, so it should be somebody who is responsible. He know what's the outcome of this kind of operation. Naam, طيب.
Number two, the legal competence of the borrower to be lent. He must be legally competent to accept the terms of the agreement, to give the lent article back.
Naam, the other party also, who want to lend, not somebody who play game to collect article something from people. If it was known that he take, I mean, if somebody lend him will not return it, then he should not give. Right? Or he doesn't understand that when he lend it, was lend it by with anything, he should return it. Unfortunately, as you know, brothers, nowadays, some people, we get shy and they take advantage of your signs. Right or not? This is what they call it, غَلَبَنِي بِسَيْفِ الْحَيَاءِ. Huh? غَلَبَنِي بِسَيْفِ الْحَيَاءِ. He beated me with the sword of shyness. طيب, I gave him my computer to use it. He took it at home and work. And I'm shy to ask him again to return to me. And this guy, you know, will never care. طيب, he told it to return maybe 1 week or 2 days or even, I'll do it and return just tomorrow. He's waiting for you to ask him. And he's shy, he said, السحي يعني عارفك. This is what they said, huh? غلبني بسيف الحياة. And this is not right and not love. To take advantage, huh? We don't call this weakness. No, in this person, but high, you know, moral and character. Huh? Yes. Right? Because maybe he's thinking, no, maybe he didn't finish. Maybe he still needs it. Now, so you give it to somebody who will return it. And he knows that it is must on him that he return it. But if I deal with somebody that if you give him something, it will be lost, then he will never. You should not give him. And there's just a joke to make this journey. They tell about one man called Juha. And Juha is a name, like, you know, not person. Juha is a name. Not like Mickey Mouse and Batman and all this, which is fiction. So whatever any of these things, they refer it to Juha. Juha said Juha did. In the Arabic culture here. Juha went and he came and borrowed pot from his neighbor. So he took it. And then after 2 days he returned it with two small pots.
He did.
They said, what is this, Ya Juha? He said, when you gave me your pot, it was pregnant.
Pregnant.
Delivered. Okay. Then now this belongs to you. It is yours. And the labor, she was not smart, you know. He went to take advantage. He thought that Juha is foolish. He said, okay, thank you. Jazakallah khair, next time if you want. So he left him sometimes. And the next time he came and took more than one, but they gave him the best and the biggest. And he took it. The next day, the following week, the following month, he asked, where is our bat? He said, عظم الله أجركم. It is this. Yes, are you foolish? You said, this bat is dead. Nobody would believe this. He said, how come you believe that?
Delivered
baby, and now you don't believe. So this is one of the jokes that, you know, tell about it. So some people, when you give him something, he will not return it to you. Right? So this kind of people, we should be, I mean, you, it's not must on you to give them. And if somebody asks your advice about them, also you should explain the situation. Your classmates ask you, Ali or Ahmed or whoever asked me to give him my computer, my notebook, whatever. So, what do you think? Said, no, don't give it to him. Why? He's not including in this. Because this person known that he doesn't retain whatever he took. Huh? Right.
Number three. The permissibility of using the lent object. For example, it is impermissible for a Muslim to lend a Muslim slave to a disbeliever.
Yeah, this is an example that we don't have it, alhamdulillah. Now there is no slavery. Okay? But he gave this example because at their time this happened. Here maybe apply in the work, for example. There's no similarity between this and slavery. But if you know that if you you have workers, and if they, somebody or other company or other party, he takes them to work in them and contract for 1 year, and you know that he will mistreat them, then you should not do it.
One question to arise.
No.
Suppose if someone is asking about the catch a player like this, a criminal item.
Nah.
The person know that he will use it for any version, any for songs and for other wrong, any.
Nah.
So he can prevent it.
Yes. Yes. If you know for sure.
You sure that
you? Yeah, for sure. You know that this person, he borrow videotape, for example, okay, or videotape recorder, or any instrument. To use it in haram way, then you should not lend it. But you are not sure, it could be used and it could not be used in this way. You expect that, like normal people, any other people, they will use it in the right way. And he used it in a wrong way, this is not your fault. Clear? It's not your fault. Yeah, but if you are sure that this person will use it, like for example, somebody ask you to give them a you are in a situation that people were fighting, right? One ran to you and said, give me your knife. You are working, for example, or, and you said, la, astaghfirullah, like I have to, you know, to obey Allah Azza wa Jal and give him. If you give him this knife, what he will do? He will kill the other person. In this case, he shouldn't. And this is why selling weapons or swords at the time of fitna is forbidden. Naam. Why? Because people, they use it to kill each other and encourage killing. So subhanallah, Islam is, you know, this what they use it now, embargo of weapons or whatever, these things that could be used in killing civilian or killing people or destruction. Huh? All this forbidden, haram. Because this is ayah said, تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. The other part, وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Right? Cooperate in whatever what? Birr. وَتَقْوَى. Right? Good. Good. Fight. وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا. And don't cooperate عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Aggression. So this is very, very clear. Now,
similarly, it is impermissible to lend a hunting tool to one in the state of ihram.
Now, for, here is another good example. Now you are hunters, and you see one muhrim, that is ihram, traveling in the land. And you know one of the muhrim, it's forbidden for him, من محظورات الإحرام الصيد, that he cannot hunt. طيب طيب وحل لكم صيد البر والبحر وحرم عليكم صيد البر ما دمتم حرما ما دمتم حرما as you are in the state of ihram hunting in the land, fishing no problem, no problem, but in the land حرم عليكم صيد البر. Okay, like goats, gazal, whatever, you know, rabbit. So somebody was in ihram, people are traveling, and you are with them, you combine them. And he saw a rabbit, and he was muhrim. And he said, give me your gun, I want to shoot this. Now in this way, you should not give it to him. Why? Because he will use it with something which is in this his situation, is not lawful. So this is another good example for this. Now,
Allah exalted be He said, but do not cooperate in sin and aggression.
نعم. ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان. نعم.
Number four, the lent article must remain as it is after use, not to be consumed as mentioned above.
Yeah, we mentioned this like food, that you consume it, okay, so you cannot retain it. نعم.
The loaner can retrieve the lent object whenever he wishes, unless it results in causing harm to the borrower. As for example, when a person lends something that causes damages to the borrower, if it is reclaimed by the loaner while it is being used.
Now, sometimes somebody took an object to use it in certain things. While he is in the middle involved, you come and tell him, okay, give me my computer. For example, he took the computer set, for example, from you to prepare for presentation, for project, and he worked hard for many nights. While, before he finished, at the middle, you come and ask him, give me your computer, give me my computer. We know that, you know, nowadays, you know, you can manage, you know, to put it in desk, put it in. But I just give you an example, if you have no choice here. And then I want it now. We said, no, this way is not allowed. Okay, why? Because this will make hard for the one. Unless you already set time for this. It's different. Okay? You will retain it this date. Then he'll take the responsibility because he should plan it very right way, so you will not finish. You lend, as he said, boat. Your neighbor asks you, you know, I'm going with my kids for fishing, can we lend this, you know, in the seaside, borrow your boat, we'll go the whole day. And when you are in the middle of the sea, he called you and said, retain my boat. How come I retain it? I'm now, at this minute, this not why? Because now you, he didn't benefit from this. So this is the point and this example that you will mention now.
To illustrate, if someone lends another a ship to carry his goods, he cannot reclaim it so long as it is in the sea. Another example is that if someone permits another to use his wall to support his wood on, the owner may not reclaim his wall as long as the wood is on it.
No.
The borrower must preserve the loan more than he preserves his own money, so as to give it back to its owner undamaged.
No, because this is amana, ikhwan. This is amana, trust. If somebody give you something, lend you something, to return it to him. This is trust in your side or not? And this was very important, especially if you borrow something that like cars. You borrow car of your friend. Some people, if it is his car, he will drive slowly, safely, try, you know, to avoid this holes in the street, especially in Jeddah, you know. Tayyib? Yeah, you see? But if this car belongs to somebody else, it will fast, you know, boom, boom, it doesn't matter with him. It's not right. And this, even it's not loan, I mean, the contract or rent, the same. Like people who are taking the cars of rental cars, rental cars. Some people, they take rental cars, they do misuse it. Some people, they rent cars just to learn how to drive. Okay? Why you don't give your kid your car? So this is very important, you know. We should care about the object or the articles of others more than what we have, because we'll be responsible for this. This is amana. Allah Azza wa Jal is observing you. If this person, if this, for example, in front of the other, the owner of this person, he will do this. He will show that you are very nice, very kind. The minute that he disappears, hello, different story. We should be aware of this. Now,
Allah, exalted be He, said, indeed, Allah commands you to render trust to whom they are due.
Now, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ. إِنَّ تَأْكِيد. كنتر. يَأْمُرُكُمْ. Order you. جمعهم. يَأْمُرُكُمْ. أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. That you should return the trust to their owners. Now,
Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 58. This verse proves the obligation of rendering back trust, including loans, safe to their owners. Moreover, the Prophet ﷺ said, the hand, referring to man, has to give back what it has taken by means of borrowing, stealing, etc.
Yeah, this is a general hadith. You can use it, you know, and to show the forbidden of stealing, of cheating, of taking somebody else's object or belonging without rights. And part of it like this, because some people, they use this kind of practice, loaning, just to steal others. Okay? He have the intention that he take your computer, right? And he have the intention that he will not return it to you. This is stealing. Okay? And the Prophet ﷺ is warning here that every hand should, I mean, if it was not here, it will be where? In the hereafter. So the question about why you didn't return the thing that you took. Now,
render the trust to him who entrusted you with it.
أد الأمانة لمن ائتمنك ولا تخن من خانك. طيب, أد الأمانة لمن ائتمنك. This is the meaning of the hadith. Render the trust to him who entrusted you. لمن ائتمنك. نعم. أد الأمانة لمن يتمنى. ما شاء الله,
هذه أمانة.
ما شاء الله, جزاكم الله خيرا. هذه اللي جابها لك فيصل. طيب, بارك الله فيك. شكرا. طيب continue.
The above legal text prove the obligation of safekeeping whatever one is entrusted with and returning it in a good condition to its owner. Loans are indicated in the general meaning of these texts, as the borrower is in fact entrusted with what he borrows and he is obliged to return it. He is only permitted to use it within the limits of usual usage. Thus, it is impermissible for a borrower to overuse the borrowed object in a way that may damage it, nor is he permitted to use it unsuitably or improperly? For he is not given permission to use this that way.
No.
Allah exalted when he says, is the reward for good anything but good?
هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان؟ وهل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان؟ The one who did good to you. Huh? Should be good or bad? You should be thankful. Pertain to him, I mean, deal with him in the best, better than the way that he did. هل جزاء الإحسان؟ This question here, a kind of question not waiting for answer. Okay? طيب هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان is the reward for good but good for sure نعم طيب
if the borrower uses the loan for any purpose other than that for which it has been lent and thus it is damaged he has to compensate for it as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the hand referring to a man has to give back what it has taken by means of borrowing.
Nah. This is the same hadith. طيب. If you lend somebody your car, طيب, and he didn't use it in the right way, he make racing, okay, instead of going in the right streets, he will go in streets, damaged streets, did anything hit other cars by purpose, I mean he was neglected by neglecting, you know, the trust that was given. Who is responsible here? The person who, why? Because he didn't use it in the right way, the normal way. But if it's the car, this is not something else. You drive it the right way, you took all the means, and something happened without any part of your side. I mean nothing on your side. You didn't cause this. Then you are not responsible. You are not responsible. Why? Because you didn't know that it will happen. Maybe the problem is before in the car, right or not?
Yes.
But it happened that appear at this time. You are driving the car in the middle of the way, you park it, and then the battery dead. Ah, I gave you the car moving, and now you return the car with dead battery? No. Because this is something that could happen. Okay? But if you, the person, he drives the car and he knows that there is no oil, there is leaking. What will happen if you drive the car without oil? The engine, what will happen to it? Huh? Who's responsible here? Not the owner. The one who used it. Because he know and see this and see the leaking. And he continue to use it. He should stop. If it was his car, he will stop. You see the difference now? So the responsibility here depends on the situation. Naam? Naam.
This hadith proves the obligation of returning whatever one has borrowed from another, and that one is not free from his duty except to returning the loan to his owner or to someone on his behalf. However, if the borrowed object is damaged while being properly used, the borrower is not financially liable for it.
Yeah, this is the example that we gave of the battery person. Now,
as the lender has permitted him for such proper utilization, thus the borrower is not obliged to make up for any damage resulting from such permitted use.
Now,
it is impermissible for the borrower to lend the borrowed thing.
Now, this is very important here. Sometimes you take, for example, from Zaid, his book or dictionary. Ibrahim took it from Zayd. And then came Muhammad and asked Muhammad, do you have the dictionary? He said, yes, this is the dictionary, and gave it to him. And it's not his. When Zayd come to Ibrahim, where's my dictionary? Well, I gave it to Muhammad, this is not right. Right? Without the permission of the owner. So you kind of say, well, this is belong to Zayd. I cannot give it to you before I talk to him. If you call him and say, okay, you can give it, then it's okay, with his permission. But just because you borrow it and it's under your hand, you have no right to lend it to another party or third party. Not.
Because whoever is permitted to use something is not permitted to lend it to someone else. For this will subject it even more to be damaged. Scholars disagree on the obligation of the borrower's liability for the damage of the loan due to misuse.
Yeah, this is one of the area of, have some differences between the ulama. Okay? Some of them, they said, he's not liable. Either use it in the proper way or he didn't. Right? And there may be point that since you gave it and you allowed him to use it, then you are the responsible. If you know that he misused it, then why should you give it to him? This is their argument here. Okay? Others, they said no. Right? But the sound opinion is the one that we mentioned. Okay? No. The we mentioned. If he misuse it, then he is liable. Now. Anyway, it's coming. Now.
Some scholars maintain that it is obligatory for the borrower to make up for the damaged loan, whether he has used it properly or not.
Yeah, this is another opinion. So we have how many now? How many opinions now? How many views? We have three. One, they say he always responsible. The other said he never the one who lend it is not responsible. Right? And the third one, which is in the middle, that said he gives the detail. If it was misused or it was used in the proper way. Now,
they base their opinion on the general meaning of the following hadith.
Now, they depend on the hadith that we mentioned earlier. Now, this applies.
The Prophet sallallahu
alayhi wa sallam. Go to the next paragraph. This applies after the hadith.
This applies, for example, when the borrowed beast dies, the borrowed garment is burned, or the borrowed object is stolen. However, some scholars are of the opinion that a borrower is not financially liable for the loan so long as he has not transgressed in its utilization.
That means he uses it in the proper way. Now,
he is liable for it only when he misuses it. Perhaps this is the most likely opinion.
Yeah, this is what the Sheikh said, that this is the most, the third one, which is sound opinion and logical opinion.
As the borrower gets the loan with the permission of its owner, so it is regarded as a trust kept by him. The borrower has to safeguard the loan, care for it, and return it to its owner as soon as he achieves the purpose of borrowing it.
Yeah, he should not leave it. I forget, wallahi, to return it to you. Don't wait for the owner to come and knock your door to take what he gave you. هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. The minute, sometimes you do it, you lose your tools, right? You have tools at home. And when other people, they take this tool to fix something, when they finish, they forget it. And you didn't ask about it. After 1 month or so, when you need it, And you ask myself, oh, I forget. I don't know where I put it. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. So this is why every Muslim should be careful about this. When you take something, the minute that you finish, you should retain it to its owner. هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان؟ نعم.
He should by no means be negligent in using it or expose it to damage.
Leave it, for example, outside. If something that could be destroyed by water, by sand or whatever. Now,
this is because the loan is regarded as a trust kept by the borrower, and its owner is supposed to have done good to him. Allah exalted be He says, is the reward for good anything but good?
No, hal jazar ihsan lil ihsan. طيب, you have any question? Is this lesson clear for everyone? Huh? Is it applicable in your life or not?
It is.
Right. Now you got more insight in this matter? Inshallah. May Allah benefit us all from whatever we learn and study and increase our knowledge in His deen. Jazakumullah khair wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad. See you inshallah next Wednesday after Salat al-Isha. Barakallah.